Good evening. My name is Ben Pierce. I am the younger son of David Pierce, so if you are here this morning, he probably made an impression of some kind. In my family, the younger you are, the more conservative you look, so I will catch up in time. We are part of something called Steiger. This is the crazy family business, I really didn't have much of a choice. I was sort of born into it. It started really when I was born in Amsterdam. It's a very long story, but what we do in Steiger is we reach and disciple global youth culture. This is a fancy way of saying young people that are outside of the church. And if you've been paying attention, this is a growing group of people. I have the privilege of traveling all over the world, and in every major urban center all over the planet, you will find these young people. They're aged roughly 17 to 35. They're connected by the media and by the internet, but they're also connected by the lies that they believe. And one of the lies that they believe is that Christianity and the church is an irrelevant tradition of the past that has no bearing on their lives. And so it is our heart to go to where they are and to share who Jesus is with them. But one of the things I'm also very passionate about is to be able to come to the church and to be able to challenge those in the church to take the gifts that God has given them and to take them outside of these walls and to make a difference. Again, I travel a lot, and it is unbelievable the brokenness. And it's not enough for just a few people to do some great things. We need everyone laying down what they have and making a difference for Him. So hopefully tonight I can encourage you and challenge you. That's my prayer. So let me just pray for us tonight, and then I'll get started. Lord, I'm incredibly grateful for this opportunity. Father, but I am desperately aware of the fact that if you don't move through my words, then that's all they will be, just words. So Lord, speak to us tonight. Father God, I don't know what people are coming here to expect, but I pray that they would get far more than they would expect, that you would wreck them for ordinary living tonight and send them out into your harvest. In Jesus' name, amen. The late Steve Jobs said, "We are here to put a dent on the universe." This was his mantra, and so I want to do an informal poll to see if he lived up to his own lifestyle philosophy. So if you own an Apple product of any kind, raise your hand. Woo, that's a dent, right? If you didn't raise your hand, have you seen a Pixar movie, Toy Story? Right? And those of you that still aren't raising your hand, you're lying. But if you aren't, if you're one of those people that's like, "I don't like Apple products," well, I hate to break it to you, but your phone or computer is made to look like one. Steve Jobs made his dent on all of us. Now, this was an earthly dent, right? It was just a material thing, and who knows if it'll be here in 100 years. This was an earthly dent. But I believe that this desire that Steve Jobs had to make a difference, to do something significant, I actually believe that this was from God. He expressed it in a very selfish way, in a very human way, but I actually believe that this was from God. Paul says in Ephesians 2:10, "For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do." Everybody here, if you were made by God, which I think is all of us, we're created to do good works. And Paul isn't meaning just religious activities, you know, things to add to your to-do list, good works. What I think he's trying to say is that we were created to make a difference, to make that dent, but an eternal one. If that's true, and I really believe it is, then why are so few of us seeing this happen? Or minimally, why are we not seeing it happen to the degree that I believe God would want it to happen? Why are we not making our dent on the universe? I believe it's because we have forgotten where the power comes from. We've forgotten where the power has come from. A common mistake that people make is they think that the key to impact is a great strategy or a great method or a great program. You see this in business, right? If a product becomes popular, all of a sudden companies everywhere are making it. You see this in the entertainment industry. You know, if a music style is popular, every artist is forced to reinvent or become irrelevant. And when your goal is to make money, this makes sense. There's typically enough room in the market for many people trying to become successful in this way, and so we see this copycat culture. But should this be happening in the church? You know, a worship band will seem to have a unique anointing, or a pastor will be filled with God's power, or a ministry will be very fruitful. And we want to know, what is their plan? You know, what is their methodology? How can we adopt what they're doing? But the reality is, real moves of God are not built on strategy. They're built on prayer. You know, the history of the mission that my parents started, it was built on a foundation of seeking God. They were called to Amsterdam in the 80s. They were both working with YWAM Youth with a Mission. They actually lived here, met there in Amsterdam. Pretty crazy story. And the dominant social movement of the time in Amsterdam were the punks and the anarchists. You know, these were young, rebellious, anti-establishment young people. And one thing they had in common is they saw the church as oppressive, as political, as irrelevant. And they were doing things to reach out to them, different programs, and they had good hearts, but they weren't seeing a breakthrough. And it was in this time they felt like God said, just stop. You know, stop all the programs and all the outreach and just pray. And so that's what they did. For 2 years, all they did was pray. I mean, they lived in the city and they built relationships, but they just prayed. They would often drive out into the forest on the edge outside of the city, and they would pray until the sun would come up, and they would ask God for his heart and his power and his plan. And God started to birth a ministry. They started this Bible study on a boat. They started this band. God started opening up doors. Fast forward 30 years later, there is a ministry all over the world, 8 different countries, seeing thousands reach for the gospel, but the foundation was prayer. Putting it into my context, when I was a teenager, we moved to New Zealand. From Holland to New Zealand, it was literally the other side of the world. And despite its incredible natural beauty, New Zealand is a very dark place. I mean, it's gorgeous, but it's dark. It's extremely secular. It's past God. It has one of the highest rates of teen suicide, domestic abuse, alcoholism, gang violence. In my high school, Christian was used as a generic insult. You didn't want to be a Christian in my high school. If you were, you didn't advertise it. This was an incredibly tough spiritual environment. And my parents, they realized that this was hard for Aaron and I, for my brother. And so my mom was like, you need to do something, David, for the boys. So we started this Bible study for us, just our friends in our living room. But if you were there this morning, you realize my dad's kind of an 11 out of 10 guy. Everything's a little bit intense. So this wasn't like pizza, bowling, laser tag Bible study. This was like intense, even though we were kids. You know, and we would often go out into the woods and we would seek God all night until the sun would come up. And the funny thing happens when you seek God in this way, he starts to break your heart. And he put this burden on our hearts for our friends. And I remember one particular prayer time, one of the guys in our group, he stopped us and he said, you know, I have this vision. I see this big tent in a field and all of our friends are gonna come and we're gonna be able to preach to them and they're gonna get saved. And we were agreeing with them. You know, we were just enthusiastic kids and we were like, yeah, God, do that. And we were praying that God would see this happen. And all I can tell you is eventually we bought this big circus tent and a local company donated all this wood and we built a stage. And the city council said, sure, you can set it up in a field right in the middle of the city. And every single month for over 2 years, we were having these evangelistic events. And hundreds of kids from our high school and the surrounding area were coming and they were hearing about Jesus and they were getting saved. And I remember this one story, this guy was driving by. He had no idea what was happening in our tent, but he said he felt like a magnet pulled him into the parking lot. And this was his way of describing the Holy Spirit. He just said, I had to go. I didn't even know what was happening. So he pulls into the parking lot and he stumbles out of his car and David is preaching and he goes into the tent and he falls on his knees and he gives his life to Jesus. And for a period of time, this outreach was impacting the entire area. Why? Because a group of high school kids started to seek God with a desperate heart. You know, it's amazing. I will share this story. Someone will come up to me after the service. I've been saying it's tents. No one's been listening to me. I knew the key was having a tent. I mean, if we just would have a tent, then we would be making a difference. Or they'll say, you know, I knew you had to use music, or it was about having a boat on, you know, Bible study on a boat, and they'll completely miss the point. You know, and you don't even know how to respond. Making a difference for God is not about a program. It's not about a strategy. It's not about a tent. It's about seeking God with a desperate heart. Hebrews 11:6 says this, without faith, it's impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who earnestly seek him. So much of our outreach, so much of our ministry, so much of our programming is ineffective because we do not take prayer seriously. Prayer has become trivial, routine, a dead tradition. There's a missionary in the early 1900s named Elizabeth Elliot, radical woman of faith, and she wrote this article on prayer that I think is worth me reading for you this evening. She writes this, people who ski happen to enjoy skiing. They have time for skiing, they can afford to ski, and are good at it. I have found that I often treat prayer as though it were a sport like skiing. Something you do if you like it, something you do in your spare time, something you do if you can afford the trouble, something you do if you're good at it. Otherwise, you do without it most of the time. When you get in a pinch, you try it, and then you call on an expert, but prayer isn't sport, it's work. Prayer is work because a Christian simply can't make a living without it. Seldom do we consider the nature of our opponent, and that is to his advantage. When we do recognize him for what he is, we have an inkling as to why prayer is never easy. Prayer is the weapon that the unseen power dreads most. And if he can get us to treat it as casually as a pair of skis or tennis racket, he can keep his hold on us. I've read this 100 times, and that gets me every time. Is this convicting at all? I mean, let's be honest. How do we treat prayer? How are our prayer meetings? Who's going to open? Who's going to close? You know, pray once. Don't pray too long. Don't pray too weird. Our prayer lives have become so domesticated, so predictable, so routine. Why? Why have our prayer lives become so weak? I think the first part of Hebrews 11:6 gives us some critical insight. Paul says, anyone who comes to him, God, must believe that he exists. Okay, I'm in a church. That seems a little obvious, right? I mean, Paul was writing to a believing audience. Isn't this a bit strange, a bit rhetorical? Why is Paul emphasizing this? I mean, surely we all believe that God exists, right? But I believe Paul is being a little pushy here. He wasn't content with their reflexive response. Do you really believe that God exists? If we were to take stock of your prayer life, of my prayer life, would our actions back up our beliefs? If I was to submit your prayer life as a transcript to a court, what would the verdict be? I think many of us say that we believe God exists, but our actions say otherwise. Or maybe we did once, but now we're realistic. Now we know how the world works. One thing I know for sure is we all need to see God more clearly. Every one of us need to see God more clearly. So who is he? How can I even start with words? Right, but I'm a musician, so this is some language that's familiar to me. I write songs, and I think about the process of writing songs. I think about all the effort and all the collaboration and all the edits and revisions and drafts and the intense labor that it takes to produce one song. And at the end of all of it, it's okay. And then I'll be out walking. I'll be in New Zealand or some country or here in some lake, and I'll look at all that God has created and all of its magnificence and all of its beauty and all of the fine-tuning and all the creativity, and to think that God just spoke it without effort into existence. Do you believe in this God? Or be on tour somewhere in a country, in a city I've never heard of with 1 million people. And I'll look out of the window, and all these people and all these needs and the brokenness and the dreams and the just overwhelming devastation, and I can barely take it. It just seems like too much. God, I can't do it. I can't reach all these people. I can barely take care of myself and my own needs. But to think that God knows every one of them by name. He knows all of their dreams. He heard them when they cried. He's angry about injustice and when they've been hurt, and he wants to rescue them and use them. Do you believe in this God? If God is really who the Bible says he is. But not only that, when we read something like, God will reward those who seek him with an earnest heart. Not sometimes, not occasionally, not maybe. God will reward you when you seek him with an earnest heart. If we believed that, would that not revolutionize how we pray? You see, having an accurate view of God will have an incredible impact on your entire spiritual life. A.W. Tozer writes this. He said, were we able to extract from any man a complete answer to this question, what comes into your mind when you think about God, we might predict with certainty the spiritual future of that man. What you think of when you think of God is the most important thing about you. There is nothing more important than what you think of when you think of God. I mean, if God is impotent, if God is indifferent, if God is far away, then prayer is cute. It's a bumper sticker. It's something we put on a coffee cup. It's a last resort. It's not real work. I mean, God, I got things to do. I got bills to pay. Prayer is great. That's cute. But I got real solutions I need to come up with here. But if God is who I'm feebly attempting to describe and so much more, then prayer is all we got. It's our only hope. It's our only strategy. When we don't see God for who he is, we turn to human solutions and we're bound by our limitations. Oh, but God, you don't know my situation. You know how little I have? You know how much I struggle? I'm not particularly talented or educated. But when it's about God, it doesn't matter what you have. It doesn't matter what you don't have. It's about him working through you when you seek him with an earnest heart. So what does this look like? What does desperate prayer look like? I keep hammering that point. Seek him with an earnest heart. What does it look like? Well, fortunately, Jesus illustrates it beautifully for us in Luke 11:5-9. He says this, suppose you have a friend and you go to him at midnight and you say, friend, lend me 3 loaves of bread. A friend of mine on a journey has come to me and I have no food to offer him. And suppose the one inside answers, don't bother me. The door is already locked and my children and I are in bed. I cannot get up and give you anything. I tell you, even though he will not get up and give you bread because of friendship, yet because of your shameless audacity, he will surely get up and give you as much as you need. Familiarity to a passage can rob you of its significance. I mean, I heard this 100 times before I let it really sink in. I mean, this is an incredibly brilliant and also hilarious passage in the Bible if you think about it. I mean, here this guy comes to a neighbor, right? And it says it was at midnight, but at that culture and that day, you went to bed as soon as it was dark. So this is really like 3 in the morning, but I think the point Jesus is trying to make is this is the worst possible time. Like, there was no worse time than this. You know, and it says that his kids were in bed. I now have a 9-month-old boy, so I know that stress, right? I also had someone come up to me and tell me that in this time, historians estimate that it was also very likely to have all your animals sleeping in the same room. So I can't imagine, like, having my 9-month-old and, like, a donkey freaking out when someone comes to the door. But that's kind of the picture here. Everything's settled, right? And you get this knock on the door. You know, and it's the worst time possible, so this has to be an emergency. Why else would someone bother me at the worst time possible? So, you know, I'm running around, the donkey's freaking out, the baby's screaming, I run to the door. It's my neighbor, okay? still probably an emergency, and then he talks. It's kind of embarrassing. I had a friend come into town. I have no food to offer him. Can I have some bread? What? Right? If this was me, it would take a while to process, but when it did, I would slam the door. He's more reasonable, and he tries to argue with him a little bit. What? This is the worst time possible. Everyone's, like, in bed. Don't bother me with this. But he's a punk, right? Nope. I've gone this far out on the limb. I'm going to get what I came for, right? Give me bread. It says, not because of their friendship. That ended shortly thereafter. I stole that joke from my dad. Gets me every time. But because of their shameless audacity. My translation, his ridiculous boldness. Because of his ridiculous boldness, he will get everything that he needs. You know, it's so funny. I read this so many times like I was the neighbor being bothered. We're not the neighbor being bothered. We're the crazy friend. That's who you are in this. You're the crazy friend in this story. Right? Jesus is the neighbor, but here's the great thing. This is hyperbole. Jesus is not bothered by your requests. And how often do we go before God like he has better things to do? Right? This must be the worst time possible. He doesn't want to hear about my requests. God is not that way. In fact, it says in places in Scripture that God actually leans in to hear from you. And Jesus is using this funny passage to illustrate what desperate prayer looks like. And I want to pull out two key aspects to desperate prayer. The first is this. Jesus wants us to pray unreasonable prayers. You know, Jesus cares about the weather this weekend. He cares that you need food to eat. He cares about you getting over your cold. He cares about all these things. He does. He's God. He loves everything about you. But I think it would bring God glory to pray for some unreasonable things, to pray for some things that only God could do. We've become so reasonable in what we ask for, so contained. I think it would bring God glory to ask for some incredible things. God, use my life to change this whole city. God, use me to reach everybody in my family for you. God, I want to see you use me to heal people, to raise people from the dead. Do something unreasonable in my life. It's like this. You get a call. I actually got a phone. You get a call. And it's Bill Gates. Ooh, okay. You like pick it up. Hey, Bill, what's happening? He's like, well, Ben, this is a bit strange. But I had this overwhelming impression when I was driving to work that I needed to give you anything you asked for. You know, all my riches, all my company, whatever you want, just name it and it's yours. Wow, Bill, that's so generous. I'm a little short on my rent this month. I could use some new shoes. There's a movie I really want to see this weekend, so maybe some cash for that. What? If Bill Gates, billionaire Bill Gates, asked me to ask him for whatever I want, I'm going to say half of what he has. Right? That seems reasonable. He can take $8 billion. I'll take $8 billion. We'll call it even. Or $1 billion, or tithe to me. Right? Christian people should get that joke. 10% of what he has is a lot of money. Dumb illustration, but you get my point. God has all resources, all power, all wisdom. And I'm not talking about material things, but God is saying to you, what do you want me to do in your life? What do you want me to do in this world through you? And we're asking for rent money. We're asking for rent money. I think Jesus would want us to be a little bit like the crazy friend asking for bread at midnight, asking for some unreasonable things. The second aspect to desperate prayer is persistent prayer. I love that the friend doesn't give up. Right? He could have just like cut his losses and said, I tried, you know, I'm going home. But he doesn't. He says, give me bread. Some of you may have prayed unreasonable prayers at one time, but you don't anymore. right? You're tired. Maybe you've been praying for the same thing for 10 years. And now you're like, I can't do it anymore. I pray for things that I can believe for now. I think Jesus would say to you, don't give up. Don't give up. Be like the widow before the unjust judge. Give me justice. Give me justice. God wants to do extraordinary things through your life. You were not meant to live an ordinary life. And I don't mean that in a material way. I mean that defined by Him, the kind of dent that Jesus would want you to make. And I am evidence that He can use ordinary people to do extraordinary things. I'm under no illusion that I can do any of what I've done without God. And I've seen evidence that when you are willing to seek Him, He does extraordinary things. I could give you so many examples, but I'll just close with one. We were on tour, and we were supposed to go to Croatia. And about a week before the tour was supposed to happen, the whole thing fell apart. And here we are, you know, this is a tour that's months in the planning. We have 20 people, 5 vehicles, tons of equipment, and we're frustrated. God, I didn't come this far to sit here. And we got together as a team, and we started praying some unreasonable prayers. We started praying some bread at midnight prayers. And God brought to our minds this crazy Albanian pastor. His name's Sabri. We called him up and said, Sabri, this is no longer music. We want to come and do a tour of your country next week. And he said, oh, wow, okay, well, I'm on vacation in Italy with my family, but I'll cancel it, and I'm on my way home. Let's do it. So we packed up our stuff. We drove 1,000 miles to Albania. With no preparation, with no planning, with no promotion, we played 12 shows in 10 days. 13,000 Albanians heard the gospel during Ramadan, and hundreds gave their lives to Jesus because God rewards those who seek Him with a desperate heart. God wants to use your life, but He is the source of power, not your ideas, not your gifts, not your strategies. But His power working through those that seek Him with a desperate heart. Amen? Amen? Lord, I just thank You for this unbelievable church that has so stood behind my family. And Lord, not in a trivial way, in a real way, they have been with us in Turkey, in Albania, in Ukraine, in Russia. When we have lifted up Your name, they were with us, Lord. But Lord, the harvest is plentiful and the workers are few, and this is not right. There are people sitting here today that are supposed to leave it all, that are supposed to row their boats to shore and ditch it and make a difference. But it's not going to come because they try harder or do more or feel bad. It's going to come when we begin to realize who You are, who we are, and that when we pray, You move. I don't know why You do it, but You do. You've done it through me, and You want to do it through these dear people. So do it, Lord. And I pray that people would leave from here changed, not because of my empty words, but because You are good, and You can use normal, ordinary people like myself. In Jesus' name, amen.
Would you stand together? Respond together, just coming to Jesus and asking Him to speak to us. You know this, let's sing it.
Are you hurting, broken within, overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to thirst for a drink from your well? Jesus is calling.
behind scenes, leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Come to the altar. Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness is bought away.
There are a few ways that you can connect with us if you feel touched, but by no means are we the only thing. I think if I could encourage you of anything is if God has touched you with this, is it doesn't get more simple than what I said. Just begin to seek Him. You know, there's nothing I've done that's just a plan or something I set out to do. It's just an inside-out process when I began to seek God and He began to move. We have a table out there for ways that you could be involved. We're teaching a class after this here at Wooddale called Jesus in the Secular World. It's just practical ways that you can learn to engage with the secular world. If you're an artist and you're wondering, how can I use these gifts for God's kingdom? We're doing a seminar at the Loring Park campus at the Music Box Theater on Tuesday the 1st. It's a free event, but it's filling up fast. Otherwise, just come talk to us at our booth, and we'd love to share what we can to help you in your journey. So otherwise, if you're new here or if you've been here a while, take the time to get to know someone. Let's not make this a place where we come and just leave. Otherwise, have a great weekend. Go Vikings. Peace.